Hello everybody and welcome back to the coolest dog training channel right here on YouTube. I'm Tom Davis, America's Canine Educator. Thank you so much for joining me today. I am forever grateful that you take the time out to watch some of the videos that I put out for you. This next video is a little bit, a sliver, a smidgen, a tiny bit of information taken from my recent seminar in Denver, Colorado. If this video brings you any value at all, consider subscribing to my channel, liking this video, and of course, leaving a comment below asking me your dog training questions and I will answer them in the comments below. Thank you so much for your valuable time. I hope you enjoyed this video. No, but seriously, thank you so much for watching. This takes us a lot of time to edit and put up for you guys. If you would, consider hit that little subscribe button right below here that says subscribe.
Experience and worrying or unease. So this is the definition of anxiousness. Usually anxiousness in dogs is a huge topic and it is probably for some of you guys in here. Anxiousness is usually created, okay? Does anybody have any questions on this before I kind of go through my little anxiety spiel? Go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Great question. That's a great question. Anybody else want to add on to that?
I have told my other Aussie is fear aggressive. He's 12 now, so I mean, and he was anxious. And when I did bring him to the behavior
from a puppy,
yeah, she pointed it out immediately and said, "This is who he is."
Mm-hmm.
And you know, we're gonna work with him, but mm-hmm. this is the dog to have.
Yeah, exactly. So those two go together. Yes.
Okay.
So, again, breed specific. Usually when I say breed specific, it means just the dog was born that way. So, again, we live in a very disposable lifestyle as humans. Living out of a van, I've realized that. Like, I can't just, like do things that I normally could in my house or in a hotel room. I couldn't just get a new towel or get a new this. Like, no, this is what I have. Like, I couldn't get a new spoon. Nope, this is all I got. Like, I'm in the middle of nowhere. And so with dogs, it's very similar. So anxiousness in dogs is sometimes hereditary. So sometimes they're born with it. There's not much you can do, except you can manage it and help it, but you can't ever make it go away. But a lot of times, other than that, I do find people create anxiety in dogs, and I'll talk about that in a second. But having a dog with anxiety, things that you can do, and what we'll do today is confidence building stuff. So anxiety with dogs that are hereditary, that are like born with it, people have it too. I don't love the idea of giving medication to dogs. I feel like it's kind of like a band-aid. I feel like it doesn't get to the root. But more importantly, I think a lot of times we can actually get to the root with actually doing exercises and actually being hands-on and being practitioners instead of just observing, which a lot of behavioralists will do. So with dogs with like that type of stuff, we do a lot of confidence building stuff. So they will typically be afraid of most things. Like they'll be afraid of the stairs, or they'll be afraid of a cot, or they'll be afraid of doing certain things. So building confidence in dogs will go hand in hand and kind of getting anxiety away because they feel like they have a job. So now I'm gonna talk about just anxiety in general for those of you who have maybe created anxiety. Anxiety created with humans is typically off of giving dogs information that they don't know and confusing the heck out of them, right? So when you say, I'm gonna leave for work now, so you have a good day, buddy. I'll leave Disney on for you. And then you leave, and that creates anxiety because you do it every day. And just like with when we teach dogs new behaviors through classical conditioning training or a Pavlovian effect, when we use markers or we use something to indicate that something's going to happen, it can also work to our disadvantage. And it can also work negatively. So we can get a dog and tell them, like, you're going to. So when dogs hear the keys, it's a trigger. When dogs see the leash, it's a trigger. Maybe when you put on your boots, it's a trigger. It's because you're teaching them that something else isn't going to happen following. It's a classical conditioning theory. It's very easy to follow. But we can also do that negatively, unfortunately. So same thing. So when you talk to your dogs and they don't understand it, it confuses them. It makes things worse. So then they're anxious all day because they're like, in their minds, they're like, they said something before they left. but I don't know what it was. I think it's important. And it confuses them and it makes them anxious. So what I tell people is, you know, that's like a big thing when people leave for work or they leave the car, like we were talking about before, is you're indicating to them, it's okay, I'll be back. So you just told them, I'm leaving you, bye. So in your mind, it's an emotion thing. Like I talked about before, the biggest problem I see people have is they mix their emotion in with dogs and it creates monsters, absolute unhealthy monsters. And it's unfortunate. If people would just understand that these are animals, they don't speak English. I will work with a dog silently almost every time I get a dog out. Like if I work a board and train. So if you sent your dog to me, I'm not gonna talk the whole time at all. But in a session, I talk the whole time because I'm talking to the owners. So that part of anxiousness is usually created from people. Is they get, and a lot of it is, there's so many of them. So please don't take this that like this is the only one. I'm just saying, in my experience, the biggest way that people create anxiety with dogs is giving them information that they don't understand. Because they love you and they want to do so much for you and they want to do everything and they're hanging on to your last breath like some sort of romantic relationship and they're just waiting for that one command and you're giving them a bunch of stuff they don't understand and then they feel complexed and they're like, I don't get that. I don't understand that. What do you want me to do? And then they become anxious. So a lot of that. Any questions on that? And then again, some of it is hereditary. It's genetics. But the other thing too also is, I guess the other thing I should say is separation anxiety. That is also created from humans by having too much love and not enough shutdown. Not enough like, hey, you can be your dog by yourself. You don't need for me to do that. So again, when we look back at the slides and we talk about what do we do when we get dogs and I dress, you know, see the pug dressed up like a little creature, we sometimes just feel like they need us. We need them more than they need us, right? And we're too attached to them. We have too much emotion going into our relationship. And that creates anxiety because then they look at you and they go, you don't know what you're doing. You can't survive out there by yourself. What are you doing? Like, you can't leave me. What's going on? You're going to die. You're not going to come back. And they don't realize that, right? And the interesting thing that I've recently discovered in dogs is my board and trains. They don't know that mom and dad just spent a ton of money for their dogs to be at my facility. They think that they're done. That's it. I'm your new owner. And then in 4 weeks, they're brilliant with me and they love me just like they love their owner. They miss their owner, sure, but now I'm their new owner and they don't care. And that's how resilient dogs are. People have no, and that clicked like literally a couple weeks ago. I'm walking one of my dogs through, I'm like, these dogs don't know the difference between this and a shelter, except, you know, the way that we, you know, operate things, right? And the consistency of the people being there. Very interesting concept that in 2 to 4 weeks, a dog will completely forget about their owners in a sense of like, they're gonna remember them, but they're gonna be moving on, next, right? And they're completely content with me and my staff and we're their new people and they love us. It's an interesting concept that literally just clicked and it really made me be it put things into perspective of me of like, dogs bounce back so fast and we need to understand that and our emotions get in the way of that. We're gonna go to work for 6 hours and we're like writing them notes, right? And that's what creates that unhealthy relationship because they're dogs, they're animals. One of my dogs is in the hotel room right now sleeping. My other dog's in there. They don't give a crap if I come or go. Right? Because I created that healthy relationship. I love you. If I want your attention, I'm going to come up to you. If you want my attention, you're going to come up to me. But I don't depend on each other for happiness. But when you're with your dog, you do. And they don't see it any other way. You're going to go out to dinner and have drinks or have coffee with your friends and family. And you're going to forget all about that for that time being. Your dog's not. They're going to sit there with the hourglass going, okay, when are they coming back? What was that? Did you hear that? Right? And the whole time is because they depend on you for certain things. And that's an unhealthy relationship. And how is that created? It's not understanding the way that dogs operate and being too, I personally think it's selfishness. I personally think